Good morning, St. Aidan's, on this Palm Sunday. We are drawing Lent to a close and we're beginning to focus on Easter with Passiontide. And that begins with this wonderful celebration of Palm Sunday, the triumphant entry of Jesus Christ into Jerusalem. We have this service at a very unusual time and at a time when we cannot physically be together. So our prayer is that this service will help you to draw to a close the period of reflection in Lent and begin to focus on the way of the cross as we walk with Jesus in this week of his passion to the ultimate powerful Resurrection Sunday next week. So I hope and pray this truly blesses you, and let me just open with a word of prayer. Father, I thank you that no matter what the situation, your eternal arms are underneath, holding us and securing us. I thank you for the great grace that you have bestowed upon us through your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. And I pray that as we begin to walk with the Lord on his triumphal entry into Jerusalem and in the week of his passion leading up to his death and resurrection, we may be drawn closer into a more deep and loving relationship with you, our Father, through him, our Saviour. We ask this in your name, Lord. Amen. Amen. Our collect for Palm Sunday. Dear friends in Christ, during Lent we have been preparing for the celebration of our Lord's Paschal mystery. On this day, our Lord Jesus Christ entered the holy city of Jerusalem in triumph. The people welcomed him with palms and shouts of praise, but the path before him led to self-giving, suffering, and death. Today we greet him as our king, although we know his crown is thorns and his throne a cross. We follow him this week from the glory of the palms to the glory of the resurrection by the way of the dark road of suffering and death. United with him in his suffering on the cross, may we share his resurrection and new life. Amen. So may the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let's pray together. Assist us mercifully with your help, Lord God of our salvation, that we may enter with joy upon the contemplation of those mighty acts, by which you have given us life and immortality, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And at this point we'll have our Gospel reading, the Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to the Gospel of Luke. Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus comes to Jerusalem as King. After Jesus had said this, he went on ahead, going up to Jerusalem. As he approached Bethage and Bethany at the hill called the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and as you enter it, you will find a colt tied there, which no one has ever ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anybody asks you, 'Why are you untying it?' say, 'The Lord needs it.'" Those who were sent ahead went and found it just as he had told them. As they were untying the colt, its owner asked them, "Why are you untying the colt?" They replied, "The Lord needs it." They brought it to Jesus, threw their cloaks on the colt, and put Jesus on it. As he went along, people spread their cloaks on the road. When he came near the place where the road goes down the Mount of Olives, the whole crowd of disciples began joyfully to praise God in loud voices for all the miracles they had seen. "Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest." Some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to Jesus, "Teacher, rebuke your disciples." "I tell you," he replied, "if they keep quiet, the stones will cry out. The Gospel of Christ. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. In our celebration of Palm Sunday, or Passion Sunday, as it's sometimes called, we do give a blessing upon the crosses that we normally pass out amongst ourselves. So let me do this anyway. We will probably be sending some of these crosses to people who are housebound. So let us bless them and pray for God's will and anointing in all of these matters. We give you thanks and praise, Almighty God, for the acts of love which you have redeemed us through your Lord Jesus Christ, our Lord. On this day that he entered Jerusalem in triumph and was proclaimed King of Kings by those who spread their garments and branches of palm along the way. Grant that these palms and we who bear these branches in his name may ever hail him as King, as our King, and follow him in the way of life, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. Amen. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. And we'll continue our praise now. Sarah Jane will play Hosanna, and Laurie will interpret it with dance. I pray that it blesses you.
Thank you. Good morning, everybody. Today's topic is not just the triumphal entry of Christ into Jerusalem, but it is also one of celebration. The gospel tells the story of Jesus riding into Jerusalem on a donkey, on a carpet of leafy branches like this, and people's cloaks, while the crowds cheered and shouted, "Hosanna! Praise to God! Celebration!" It seemed a spontaneous festival event was in the making. You might wonder, celebration? What a strange topic to speak on during this time of pandemic with imposed isolation and quarantine, and yes, even death. But let's look at the times of Jesus. Perhaps it was not as different for the people who made up the cheering crowd. Let's also examine a little closer what celebration looks like and feels like from within and during the rough times. So the setting is that Jesus seems to be at the peak of his ministry, doing miracles and teaching in the synagogue and out in the open, teaching in parables and story and clear explanations. Lately, Jesus has been teaching his disciples that he will suffer and die. Meanwhile, the Jewish people are still oppressed by Rome. Although there was a measure of religious freedom, life was not easy, and any behavior that threatened the peace was aggressively quashed. Jesus was being warned by many that the religious authorities were looking for him, and by implication, the Roman authorities as well. But Passover was coming, and Jesus sets out for Jerusalem regardless of the warnings, but not in the usual fashion this time. When they had come near Jerusalem and had reached Bethphage at the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go into the village ahead of you, and immediately you will find a donkey tied and a colt with her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, just say this, 'The Lord needs them,' and the owner will send them immediately." This took place to fulfill what had been spoken through the prophet, saying, "Tell the daughter of Zion, look, your king is coming to you, humble and mounted on a donkey and on a colt, the foal of a donkey." That's a prophecy found in Zechariah 9:9, in case you want to look it up. The disciples went and did as Jesus had directed them. They brought the colt and put their cloaks on it, and Jesus sat on it. And then a very large crowd started gathering and spread their cloaks on the road and many palm branches in front of them as well. The crowds that went ahead of him and followed were shouting, "Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord! Hosanna in the highest heaven!" By the time he entered Jerusalem, the whole city was in turmoil, asking, "Who is this?" The crowd's words are equivalent to saying, "This is our coming King, Jesus, the Messiah." They shout out praises and blessings on Jesus, using words that indicate they believe this is the Messiah for whom they've been waiting. The narrative indicates that this action of riding into Jerusalem on a lowly donkey, fulfills an Old Testament prophecy from Zechariah that the coming king will ride into Jerusalem on a donkey. And apparently the Jewish people all seem to understand the importance of that prophecy. And so they celebrated. So let's now look at a few elements of celebration. One is that God provides for times of celebration. If you flash back to Ecclesiastes, a word of wise sayings as written by the preacher, we hear that there is a time to mourn and a time to celebrate. There is a time for joy and a time for sorrow. There is a time to die and a time to live. Can we take the long view today? And can we see this in the perspective of joy in the middle of sorrow? So there's joy, there is sorrow, there is joy, there is sorrow. It's part of the rhythm of life. The rhythm of the Lenten season itself allows for both lament and celebration. We are to fast during the week and feast on Sundays. Our church fathers and mothers were wise in planning for a weekly celebration, don't you think? Perhaps they knew we, as a kind of a frail people, would get discouraged in faith and in life without a break during that long Lenten season of mourning and repentance. And thirdly, let's look at the Passover festival. It was established after the release from slavery in Egypt. However, this celebration, that is, the entry of Jesus into Jerusalem, took place prior to the arrest, torture, and crucifixion of Jesus. That's something to ponder. What was it meant to tell the people? Maybe Jesus was trying to say, this is God's plan for the Messiah. You greet him as king, but he goes on and takes the path that leads towards crucifixion. But it is a path that leads to also to eternal salvation for the people of God. In fact, the whole world. Fourthly, it occurred to me that we have the great advantage of praising God. We go through Palm Sunday as though it were the time of Jesus, but we know we are speaking from after the resurrection. And so we know that Jesus is Lord, Jesus is King. So despite the appearance of Jesus on a lowly donkey, we know he's really going to be King, King of people's hearts. And though he went on to walk the path of the cross, we have the great advantage of seeing this from the other side of the resurrection, the other side of the grave. We know that Jesus, the Messiah King, conquered death. We know he rose from the grave and went on to give us his Holy Spirit and is now alive and sitting or seated beside God, called the Ancient of Days or the Father of all. And Jesus continually intercedes, prays for us. So I'm just wondering, what does celebration look like for you in this season? Or what will it look like for you? So I looked for examples of celebration within our current time of Lent, but also in our current time with the imposition of quarantine and physical distancing. I saw in a recent post on Facebook by Jeff Lucan that the family all took their bikes on the van, and they went out to the countryside and they cycled, I don't know where, they found a path somewhere, and then they had a wiener roast together. Well, that sounds like celebration. Celebration in the middle of school being canceled and in the middle of physical distancing. But as a family, they were able to celebrate. Last week, I saw in the news that a couple from Gateway Church were married in church on the planned date. They had canceled the dinner and the reception with its merrymaking. They canceled the invitations to the wedding, but they went ahead with the marriage ceremony in the church with just a few friends and family. And then when they exited the church, there was a whole crowd of cars honking their horns, people waving streamers and banners and shouting congratulations. So they got a celebration, just a slight change in format. There's numerous suggestions on the news, on Facebook, and other media to generate a few laughs. Well, there's always good jokes and then there's not so good jokes, but I've found some good ones. I'm sure you have too. But also ideas like singing from the balconies, that started in Italy. Clapping for the healthcare workers. I don't know where that started, but it certainly was big in the UK. And I think somebody's trying to start it here in Winnipeg, so look for that in the news. I'm sure it'll be on there. Or we hear of people taking the opportunity to cook a great meal at home when they haven't cooked at home for some time. Or baking bread from scratch, and they haven't done that for a long time. These are all celebratory events, celebratory activities, and they are taking place in the time of pandemic. So that is something that Jesus has allowed for, God has allowed for in creation of this world and in creating us as a social being, as people. So all kinds of suggestions to count our blessings, increase our compassion, to exercise grace toward one another, take more pictures to send to friends and loved ones, learn a new medium like Zoom so you can share your supper conversation, and to learn to be content. St. Paul says from his prison cell, I have learned in whatever situation I am to be content. I think contentment is a great precursor to celebration. A deep down contentment in who I am, who God created me to be. A deep down contentment in who God is, as Father, as Jesus the Son, and as the Holy Spirit, who is ultimately in charge of this world. Dr. Jack Serra, who's president of Bethlehem Bible College, wrote a letter to some of the people interested in the college, and in it he quotes the scripture from Philippians, be anxious for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God, and the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. What not to celebrate when God is in control of our world? And the same for the people of Jerusalem. What not to celebrate? Jesus, their King, was coming down the road. Thanks be to God. Amen. Chris is going to come and lead us in prayers.
First, our collect for the Passion. Almighty and ever-living God, in tender love for all our human race, you sent your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, to take our flesh and suffer death upon a cruel cross. May we follow the example of his great humility and share in the glory of his resurrection through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And now our intercessions. Is it nothing to you, all who pass by? Look and see if there is any sorrow like my sorrow, which was brought upon me, which the Lord inflicted on the day of his fierce anger. Holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal One, have mercy upon us. O my people, O my church, what have I done to you, or in what have I offended you? Testify against me. I led you forth from the land of Egypt and delivered you by the waters of baptism, but you have prepared a cross for your Savior. Holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal One, have mercy upon us. I led you through the desert these 40 years and fed you with manna. I brought you through tribulation and penitence and gave you my body, the bread of heaven, but you prepared a cross for your Savior. Holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal One, have mercy upon us. What more could I have done for you that I have not done? I planted you, my chosen and fairest vineyard. I made you the branches of my vine. But when I was thirsty, you gave me vinegar to drink and pierced me with a spear, the side of your Savior. Holy God, holy and mighty, holy immortal one, have mercy upon us. I went before you in a pillar of cloud, and you have led me to the judgment hall of Pilate. I scourged your enemies and brought you to a land of freedom, but you have scourged, mocked, and beaten me. I gave you water from the rock, but you have given me gall and left me to thirst. Holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal one, have mercy upon us. I gave you a royal scepter and bestowed the keys to the kingdom, but you have given me a crown of thorns. I raised you on high with great power, but you have hanged me on a cross. Holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal one, have mercy upon us. My peace I gave you, which the world cannot give, and washed your feet as a sign of my love. But you draw the sword to strike in my name and seek high places in my kingdom. I offered you my body and blood, but you scatter and deny and abandon me. Holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal one, have mercy upon us. I sent the Spirit of Truth to guide you and to choose to close your hearts to the Counselor. I prayed that all may be as one in the Father and me, but you continue to quarrel and divide. I call you to go and bring forth good fruit, but you cast lots for my clothing. Holy God, holy and mighty, holy immortal one, have mercy upon us. I grafted you into the tree of my chosen Israel, and you turned on them with persecution and mass murder. I made you joint heirs with them of my covenants, but you made them scapegoats for your own guilt. Holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal one, have mercy upon us. We glory in your cross, O Lord, and praise and glorify your holy resurrection, for by virtue of your cross, joy has come to the whole world. May God be merciful to us and bless us, show the light of his countenance, and come to us. Let your ways be known upon the earth, your saving health among all nations. Let the peoples praise you, O God. Let all the peoples praise you. We glory in your cross, O Lord, and praise and glorify your holy resurrection. For by virtue of your cross, joy has come to the whole world. Amen.
In our readings today, in our prayers and reproaches, in Deacon Margaret's word, we have heard of the passion and pain of Christ, the joy and sadness, the celebration and the devastation. Christ walked this way, this path, for a purpose.